Welcome back. Well, yesterday, 11 anti-Trump protesters and the president of the Black Lives Matter New York chapter were arrested during a counter-protest in Manhattan. Now, this all happened when some pro-Trump supporters gathered in Madison Square Park for a caravan event. The anti-Trumpsters then turned it all violent. They began yelling and screaming at police and then spurring up minor fights when they confronted the caravan. The president of the local BLM chapter, Walter Hawk Newsom, was given a ticket for obstruction and also two disorderly conduct violations. Go figure. Take a look. More of that following the Constitution, right, folks? Peaceful assembly. Yeah. Looks like it to me. That's what the left's all about, following the rules, right? Our next guest is the director and senior analyst for Homeland Security and Counterterrorism at the Center for Security Policy. Please welcome to the show, Kyle Shideler. Kyle, thank you so much for joining Real America tonight. Appreciate it.
Thank you for having me. It's good to be here.
So, I hate to say this right before, because I am not one to fearmonger, unlike the folks over at some of those other lamestream media networks who have been instilling fear, I think, in the country for the past 8 months since COVID and the election, you name it. But we just showed some video, hopefully you heard that story before you, about BLM and Antifa. And I know that you were one of the authors of Unmasking Antifa, the new book out, Five Perspectives on a Growing Threat. We know we're gonna see violence tomorrow, no matter which way this thing goes. And if, and I believe, when President Trump gets reelected, we're going to see it on a scale like we have not seen all year long. Would you agree?
I think it's very worrisome. Part of the problem is on the radical left and supported in elements of the media is a narrative that there is no possible way that President Trump could be reelected other than by cheating, other than by theft, other than by voter intimidation. And so they have spun up this argument that the president is a fascist, that he is preparing a coup, and terrified their supporters such that in the event that the president should win, or if the race should be close and we don't know what the outcome is going to be on election night, that they will take to the streets in an attempt to set the outcome on their own.
And I almost think, because a lot of these really true hardcore Antifa freaks that you see out in the streets, at one point they were anti-Joe Biden even, because they didn't want any of the establishment type candidates from the left or the right. I mean, if you hear or look at some of the blogs that some of these wackos put out there that belong to Antifa and even some of the BLM ones, I mean, they don't want any type of establishment. They wanted a Bernie character or even someone even further to the left than that. So I'm going to stick with, I think, no matter which way it goes, if Biden were to win this thing hands down or Trump and it's a landslide either way, I think they're going to be coming out and tearing up cities, burning businesses, rioting, looting, no matter what. That's been their game plan. I mean, it has happened all summer long before you get any facts of any of these cases where someone may have been shot, beaten up by cops, whatever it may be. Look what they did just with that. And this has all been culminating to tomorrow night, which we may not know the results because of the millions of mail out and then mail back in ballots. Would you agree with that?
I would, and I think that's something that they have explicitly said. There was a anarchist trainer named Lisa Thithian who spoke to a group called Shutdown DC, and she told them, you know, you have to work for the enemy you want. And by what she meant by that was Joe Biden. So what they really want is a Joe Biden administration that they can then intimidate
right
through street action in order to achieving their radical objectives. So this, they really see this as merely one step on their way towards establishing radical dominance in the United States.
Yeah, thank you for pointing that out.
You and I, that's what they work for every day.
Yeah, I read something similar to what you're talking about, where they said they will do 100 years of chaos to obtain peace and what they want. They literally are fine with burning down cities, attacking people, doing what they've been doing to get their agenda put into place, which kills me because they're saying they're anti-fascist when they're acting like a bunch of fascists. Anyway, I shouldn't laugh about it. It's freaking scary what's going on in our country right now. But I agree with you. We had some video, and you may be able to attest to it. I'm not sure what town you're in, but it looks like a bunch of the businesses in D.C. since last Thursday or Friday, I think, they've been boarding stuff up. They're getting ready. They know this is coming.
Right. And it's quite clear that they know that this is going to be coming from the radical left, you know, in D.C., in Philadelphia, in New York City, every night in Portland and Seattle. The business owners are dealing with this situation. They know where the violence is coming from. We're seeing spin from some elements of the media trying to claim that these folks are afraid of Trump voters somehow. But it's nonsense. The reality is everybody knows that there will be violence. It will come from the radical left. It will come from Antifa. It will come from the BLM rioters. And we have to be prepared for a media that is going to ignore that, to try to make it hard for us to see that. You may see shutdowns on social media where it becomes more difficult for us to be aware of what's actually happening on the ground in some of these places. But that's the reality. And the business owners know that. The people who are boarding up their stores know that. They're worried about Antifa. They're worried about BLM. They're not worried about your average Trump caravan attender.
Yeah, when's the last time, except for the fender bender that happened in Texas, and we don't want to condone any type of violence or road rage, there was a little meeting of a Trump vehicle down in Texas this past weekend, I believe on Friday or Saturday, with the Biden bus, which scared them out of Texas, and they decided to cancel, like, I don't know, four other events. We'd never want that. But typically, every single one of these Trump caravans, Trump boat parades, you name it, is peaceful. No one is out there to cause problem, just to show their support for the president and this country. That's why I don't understand how anyone on its face value could look at the two candidates, look at the two movements of pro-America, pro-conservative values, pro-democracy, standing up for our republic and what it stands for, law and order in the Constitution, versus these whack jobs in the street and violence and the leaders of this party not doing enough to condemn it, come out and outright say, this is wrong, stop it. Instead, they just placate them. Well, you know, they've got a movement. It's a movement, they say. I mean, the excuses that Biden and Harris use to let these thugs off the hook, and then the mainstream media standing in front of fires and going, it's mostly peaceful. How do you get past that, Kyle? How are they getting away with this is what kills me in this day and age. Aren't we all smart enough to shut this crap down? And to what you said, if the president gets in, they will shut these folks down on Antifa and these violent rioters, where a Biden, like you said, will be able to get pushed around by his own party.
And as you noted, the movement behind the president is a movement for law and order. And that's actually one of the things that the radical left hates the most. You look at the connection, the respect that the Trump supporters have for law and order, for the police, the sort of the back the blue movement that has grown up in response to what we've seen with Antifa and BLM. And they hate that the most. That's what they view as just really unacceptable. That's when they start throwing around terms like fascism, just because Americans love their neighborhood policemen.
Yeah. Isn't that interesting that unions are backing a Republican candidate? When's the last time since the days of, like, Jimmy Hoffa and the Kennedys and back in the day? It's always been unions backing a Democrat. I find that very, very telling. That should show you right there who's going to win tomorrow. They're wrapping me up, Kyle, but I got to have you pitch the book, man. I know you're one of several authors that did this book called Unmasking Antifa, Five Perspectives on a Growing Threat. If we grab that book, one, where can we grab it real quick, and what will we be reading about?
Sure. It's available on Amazon.com if you want to see it. It is five really great thinkers talking about Antifa, the ideology, the history, the financing, the tactics, how it works. It also includes my written testimony before the U.S. Senate Subcommittee on the Judiciary, which had a hearing on Antifa. That so it's worth checking out.
Yeah, very eye-opening. Thank you, Kyle, so much. Kyle Ginn's the Director and Senior Analyst for Homeland Security and Counterterrorism at the Center for Security Policy. Kyle, thank you so much. Stay safe, brother. Get out there and vote if you haven't done so. You take care. Have a good night.
Thank you.
Coming up, she's a rising star in the conservative movement, the host of a widely popular podcast, Alex Clark, joining Real America when we come back. Don't go away.
Needless to say, what's going to be happening in Iowa on the 8th of February is going to be very, very important. You're the beginning. You're the folks that are going to start this long and interesting presidential derby. And I would be less than candid if I didn't say to you that I would like to have the support of every single one of you in this room, and I hope I will, and I hope you'll be at those caucuses. The eyes of the nation are going to be on Iowa, I can assure you. And Iowa is going to play a very, very important role. As a matter of fact, it's conceivable that Iowa could literally nominate the next president of the United States in the 8th of February.